daughter, Helen Rossetti Angelini, wrote about the purported last message, stating, "Lizzie's last message, as reported, is touching and romantic, but she did not write it. The note did not survive, and so it is impossible to know if this account is true." It has been argued that Angelini may have been trying to refute a consistent rumor that Gabrielle had murdered Lizzie, or, at the very least, driven her to suicide by his cruel behavior. Oscar Wilde told everyone that Gabrielle had pushed the bottle into her hands and told her to drink the lot before storming out of the house. Then we have Lizzie's last poem, "O Lord, May I Come," written in a shaky and straggling hand, which William Rossetti thought must have been written under the influence of laudanum. It is possible that Gabrielle was referring to this poem when he told Hall Caine of a message to him left by Lizzie's bed. "Life and night are falling from me, death and day are opening on me. Wherever my footsteps come and go, life is a stony way of woe. Lord, how I long to go. Hollow hearts are ever near me, soulless eyes have ceased to cheer me. Lord, may I come to thee. Life and youth and summer weather, to my heart no joy can gather. Lord, lift me from life's stony way. Loved eyes long closed in death watch for me. Holy death is waiting for me. Lord, may I come today. My outward life feels sad and still, like lilies in a frozen rill. I am gazing upwards to the sun. Lord, Lord, remembering my lost one. O Lord, remember me. How is it in the unknown land? Do the dead wander hand in hand? God, give me trust in thee. Do we clasp dead hands and quiver with an endless joy forever? Do tall white angels gaze and wend along the banks where lilies bend? Lord, we know not how this may be. Good Lord, we put our faith in thee. O God, remember me." Overcome with grief and remorse, Gabrielle kept Lizzie's coffin in their apartment for 6 days. Before the coffin was sealed, he placed a manuscript of his poems between her cheek and hair. Lizzie, the beautiful wraith, was then buried in Highgate Cemetery. It was said that he saw a ghost every night for 2 years. When Gabrielle buried his only manuscript of poems with Lizzie in her coffin, he never thought of the hard times ahead. Suffering from depression, addicted to chloral hydrate and pondering an ever-decreasing bank balance, 7 years after Elizabeth's body was lowered into the ground, he had her corpse secretly entombed so he could retrieve the notebook. He transcribed the stinking, tattered manuscript that had wormholes and the stains from decomposition in some of his best lines, but he never fully recovered from his sense of guilt and shame. Rossetti was to have other relationships, most notably with his models Fanny Cornwolf and Jane Burden Morris, but Lizzie was a constant presence. The savage reaction of critics to Rossetti's first collection of poetry contributed to a mental breakdown in June 1872, and although he joined Jane Morris at Kelmscott that September, his first days in a haze of chlorine and whiskey. There followed many years of physical and emotional decline, punctuated by depression, attempted suicide, and drug and alcohol abuse, which caused him to lead a very reclusive existence. Not long before he died in April 1882, Rossetti wrote, "As much as in 100 years she's dead, It is today the day on which he died. Sunday, 1882, he died at the country house of a friend where he had gone in a vain attempt to recover his health, which had been destroyed by his addiction to chloral, just as his wife's had been destroyed by laudanum. He died of Bright's disease, a disease of the kidneys from which he had been suffering for some time. He had been housebound for some years on account of paralysis of the legs. Though his chloral addiction is believed to have been a means of alleviating pain from a botched hydrocele removal. He had been suffering from alcohol psychosis for some time. This had been brought on by the excessive amounts of whiskey he used to drown out the bitter taste of the chloral hydrate. He is buried at Birchington-on-Sea, Kent, England. Well, my dear friends, I hope you enjoyed that true Victorian story. I was very much into the Pre-Raphaelite artists when I was in my early 20s. Still am. I love their work. And at that time, me and my ex-girlfriend were really into that whole, the whole romantic sort of Gothic Victorian. And this story in particular really inspired us. We loved it. Bought a lot of the books and art. Of course, Prince couldn't afford the real paintings. They were all hanging in museums, but bought some very good quality prints. Thick paper and very good ink. And I still actually have a lot of these prints. Some of them are framed, some of them are still in cardboard rolls. Ophelia I do have. And at that time, I had a lot of money. I wasn't earning much, so I spent a lot of money on this art and the books, more than I can afford to think I love their art. The photo you're looking at now of Gabriel Rossetti's grave and Elizabeth's grave, obviously he was buried somewhere else. This is in the Highgate Cemetery in London. He was buried, when you read the story you can see he was buried elsewhere. This must be like just a memorial stone to him. My ex-girlfriend actually took this photo in the early 90s when she went to London. I was not with her at the time when she took this, when she gave me the photos. I myself have been to Highgate Cemetery when I was younger. Beautiful, it really is. If you haven't been, if you're ever going on holiday, it's definitely worth a visit. Don't think of it as a creepy cemetery. It's really some beautiful works of art in that cemetery. It's fantastic. I'm getting sidetracked. Yeah, so we just loved that story. It was just so sad and possibly romantic and creepy at the same time. It's got all the ingredients. So I'll just give you a little bit of a background to why I decided to cover this story. I've been meaning to for a long
time. That
is.
One
day I'm going to get around to framing my Ophelia print. I do have an original 18th century frame for it. Which I've carried around for decades. With the print, I still haven't done it. Unbelievable. Got to do it soon. Now I am inspired again. And the Lady of Shalott, you also saw in one of the earlier slides, by John William Waterhouse. I had that too framed. I have quite several of their works. I have in print form. Yes, while backpacking in the 90s, I went to have a look at the actual painting of Ophelia by John Everett Millais at the Tate Gallery. It was a lot smaller than I expected, a really beautiful jewel of a painting, just exquisite. I didn't feel let down at all. It's a fantastic painting. It still speaks to me after all these years. Yes, it has a very haunting and ethereal quality to it. And of course, knowing how this young lady suffered for art adds another dimension to it. I just love that painting. Anyway, enough of that ramble, and now on to the next ramble. Yes, any of my Patreon members out there who haven't received the notification yet of my latest upload there, well, I'm announcing it now. It's my take on the Black Dahlia, a very tragic and horrifying case.
That's as much as we can do today.
Fantastic feedback there, so if you haven't seen it yet, log in and check it out. And for any of you, if
we are
new to YouTube and don't know about Patreon,
that's as much as I can do.
In the description and in the pink comment below this video. So you can go over there and if you want to sign up.